The law of God is holy and immutable, a transcript of his character. The law of God is truth, unchanging, eternal truth. It is holy, just and good. God's law is a transcript of his own character and reflects the principles of his government. It is the standard of Christian character. His precepts are consistent with his attributes. The law of love is the foundation of God's government. God is love, and his law is love. Its two great principles are love to God and mankind. Love is the fulfilling of the law. Romans 13 verse 10. It is by beholding that we become changed. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and every one that loveth is born of God, and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. 1 John 4 verses 7 and 8. In his sacred precepts God has opened to men the perfection and holiness of his character. When Moses asked God, "Show me thy glory," the Lord answered, "I will make all my goodness pass before thee." Exodus 33 verses 18 and 19. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season, his leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doth shall prosper. Psalm 1 verses 1 through 3. It is only as the law of God is restored to its rightful position that there can be a revival of primitive faith and godliness among his professed people. Thus saith the Lord, "Stand ye in the ways, and see, and ask for the old paths, where is the good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your souls." Jeremiah 6 verse 16. Christ is a perfect revelation of God. No man hath seen God at any time, the only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. 1 John 1 verse 18. Philip saith unto him, "Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us." Jesus saith unto him, "Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father, and how sayest thou then, Show us the Father? Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake." John 14 verses 8, 9, and 11. To those who receive Jesus and believe on him, he gives power to become the sons of God. Christ came to our world to declare the character of God as it is represented in his holy law. He was both the law and the gospel. God's law looks into the secrets of the heart. Every act is judged by the motives that prompt it. Only that which is in accord with the principles of God's law will stand in the judgment. When those who claim to be children of God become Christ-like in character, they will be obedient to God's commandments. Clothed in the glorious apparel of Christ's righteousness, they have a place at the King's feast. They have a right to join the blood-washed multitude. Sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified through the truth. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. And the glory which thou gavest me I have given them, that they may be one, even as we are one. I in them, and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, and hast loved them, as thou hast loved me." John 17 verses 17 through 23. The only mediator between God and man. Christ is our mediator and officiating high priest in the presence of the Father. He was shown to John as a lamb that had been slain, as in the very act of pouring out his blood in the sinner's behalf. When the law of God is set before the sinner, showing him or her the depth of their sins, they should then be pointed to the Lamb of God, that taketh away the sin of the world. John 1 verse 29. They should be taught repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. Christ is our advocate. He is standing between man and the eternal throne. He is ever ready to meet our every effort and by His Spirit assist us to a more perfect knowledge of God. The Lamb of God is represented as in the midst of the throne of God. He is the great ordinance by which humans and God are united and commune together. Thus mankind is represented as sitting in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. This is the appointed place of meeting between God and humanity. Those who accept Christ's gospel behold Him with open face. They see the relation of His mission to the law. Moreover, they acknowledge God's wisdom and glory as revealed by the Savior. The glory of Christ is revealed in the law, which is a transcript of His character. Furthermore, His transforming grace works in the soul until he or she become changed to His likeness. They are made partakers of the divine nature, and grow more and more like their Savior. Thus they are advancing step by step in conformity to the will of God till they reach perfection. The Great Controversy. The rebellion against the law of God has begun by Satan in heaven. Thus sin was brought into existence. He declared the divine law to be arbitrary. Moreover, to be detrimental to the interests of the heavenly universe, and in need of change. Throughout his rebellion he has sought to represent God as an unjust, tyrannical being. Satan and his followers threw the blame of their rebellion wholly upon Christ. They declared that if they had not been reproved, they would never have rebelled. Thus strong-willed in their disloyalty they were seeking to overthrow the government of God. The same spirit that prompted rebellion in heaven still inspires rebellion on earth. Satan has continued with human race the same policy which he pursued with the angels. His spirit now reigns in the children of disobedience. Like him they seek to break down the restraints of the law of God and promise men and women liberty through transgression of its precepts. Reproof of sin still arouses the spirit of hatred and resistance. When God's messages of warning are brought home to the conscience, Satan leads individuals to justify themselves and to seek the sympathy of others in their course of sin. Instead of correcting their errors, they excite indignation against the reprover, as if he or she were the sole cause of difficulty. From the days of righteous Abel to our own time, such is the spirit which has been displayed toward those who dare to condemn sin. Satan is the prince of evil and the author of sin. He is the first transgressor of God's holy law. Satan's enmity against Christ has been manifested against his followers. The same hatred of the principles of God's law and the same policy of deception may be traced in all the history of the past. Thus error has made to appear as truth. Moreover, human laws were substituted for the law of God and people were led to worship the creature rather than the Creator. Christ vindicated the honor of God's law in his ministry, death, and resurrection. The Pharisees prided themselves on their obedience to the law. Yet they knew so little of its principles through everyday practice that to them the Savior's words sounded like heresy. He read their thoughts, and answered them, saying, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law, or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill." Matthew 5 verse 17. It was not merely to accomplish the redemption of man that Christ came to the earth to suffer and to die. His mission to the world is to vindicate the sacred claims of that law which they charge him with breaking. He came to magnify the law and to make it honorable. If the law of God could have been changed or abrogated, then Christ need not have suffered the consequences of our transgression. He came to explain the relation of the law to mankind and to illustrate its precepts by his own life of obedience. Thus he demonstrated to the inhabitants of this world how the law should be regarded. Furthermore, it was to be demonstrated to all the worlds of the universe that God's law is unchangeable. The death of Christ proves the law of God is immutable. Could its claims have been set aside, then the Son of God need not have yielded up his life to atone for its transgression. The sacrifice to which infinite love impelled the Father and the Son, that sinners might be redeemed, demonstrates to all the universe that nothing less than this plan of atonement could have sufficed to do, that justice and mercy are the foundation of the law and government of God. By his life on earth Christ honored the law of God. By his death he established it. Jesus gave his life as a sacrifice, not to destroy God's law or create a lower standard. Furthermore, that justice might be maintained, the law might be shown to be immutable, and stand fast forever. The law was given to convict mankind of sin. When the law was proclaimed from Sinai, God made known to men the holiness of his character, that by contrast they might see the sinfulness of their own. The law was given to convict them of sin, and reveal their need of a Savior. It would do this as its principles were applied to the heart by the Holy Spirit. This work it is still to do. In the life of Christ the principles of the law are made plain. As the Holy Spirit of God touches the heart and the light of Christ reveals to humans their need of his cleansing blood and his justifying righteousness, the law is still an agent in bringing us to Christ, that we may be justified by faith. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. Psalm 19 verse 7. Till heaven and earth pass, Jesus said, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. The elements of nature, the sun shining in the heavens and the solid earth upon which you dwell are God's witnesses that his law is changeless and eternal. Though they may pass away, the divine precepts shall endure. It is easier for heaven and earth to pass, than one tittle of the law to fail. Luke 16 verse 17. The system of types that pointed to Jesus as the Lamb of God was to be abolished at his death, but the precepts of the Decalogue are as immutable as the throne of God. Satan's accusations. Satan had claimed that it was impossible for man to obey God's commandments. In our own strength it is true that we cannot obey them. But Christ came in the form of humanity, and by his perfect obedience he proved that humanity and divinity combined can obey every one of God's precepts. As many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. John 1 verse 12. This power is not in the human being. It is the power of God which saves and transforms. When a soul receives Christ, he or she receives power to live the life of Christ. Many use the texts that speak of the ceremonial law to prove that the moral law of God has been abolished. This is a perversion of the scriptures. The distinction between the two systems is broad and clear. The ceremonial system was made up of symbols pointing to Christ, to his sacrifice and priesthood. This ritual law, with its sacrifices and ordinances, was to be performed by the Hebrews until type met anti-type in the death of Christ, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Then all the sacrificial offerings were to cease. It is this law that Christ took, out of the way, nailing it to his cross. Colossians 2 verse 14. Concerning the law of 10 commandments the psalmist declares. Forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in heaven. Psalm 119 verse 89. And Christ himself says, think not that I am come to destroy the law, or the prophets, I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. Matthew 5 verses 17 and 18. Here he teaches, not merely what the claims of God's law had been, and were then, but that these claims should hold as long as the heavens and the earth remain. The law of God is as immutable as his throne. It will maintain its claims upon mankind in all ages. Jehovah is the supreme governor of nations. There is no greater or more fatal deception taking hold on human minds than one that leads people to declare that the law of God has been abolished. Were this so, there could be no judgment. For there would be no rule by which character could be tested and actions weighed. But we read in the Word of God that the judgment is to sit, and the books are to be opened. Everyone is to be rewarded according as his or her works have been. If God has no moral standard by which to measure character, there can be no judgment and no reward. Those who presume to think that the law of God has been done away, and that it no longer exists, have set up an imperfect standard of their own. Measuring themselves by their own finite standard, they pronounce themselves pure and perfect. No one who has an appreciation of the verity of the law of God will claim an exalted character for himself or herself. There is perfect harmony between the law of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ. I and my Father are one. John 10 verse 30. The gospel is the good news of grace by which mankind may be released from the condemnation of sin, and enabled to render acceptable obedience to the law. The gospel points to the moral code as a rule of life. That law, by its demands for undeviating obedience, is continually pointing the sinner to the gospel for pardon and peace. For all have sinned, and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in His blood, to declare His righteousness for the remission of sins that are past, through the forbearance of God, Romans 3 verses 23 through 25. Do we then make void the law through faith? God forbid. Yeah, we establish the law. And again the apostle declares that the law is holy, and the commandment holy, and just, and good. Romans 7 verse 12. While we point the sinner to Jesus as the one who can take away sin, we must explain to him or her what sin is, and show them that they can be saved from their sins, but not in them. They must be made to realize that sin is the transgression of the law. Paul made the inquiry many years after the death of Christ. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law, for I had not known lust, except the law had said, Thou shalt not covet. Romans 7 verse 7. The law of God serves to detect sin and discovers the defects in the moral character. Christian character is perfected through obedience to its requirements. There is no quality in law to save the transgressor of the law. My little children, these things write I unto you, that ye sin not. And if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. 1 John 2 verses 1 and 2. The law can condemn, but it cannot pardon. Therefore the transgressors would have been left to perish in their wretchedness if a plan had not been devised for their salvation. Jesus Christ alone was able to save fallen race. He became their surety and substitute. Christ became their advocate pleading before the Father. It was for our sake that He condescended to become man. Our Savior is the Son of Man as well as the Son of God. Jesus took humanity upon Himself, and presented a model for humanity in His pure and perfect character. He did no sin, neither was guile found in His mouth. 1 Peter 2 verse 22. His life was as complete as a pattern, as His death was complete as a sacrifice. He was tempted in all points like as we are, therefore He knows how to help those that are tempted. How to reconcile to God. Conviction of sin is the first step in reconciliation to God. Sin is the transgression of the law. By the law is the knowledge of sin. 1 John 3 verse 4, Romans 3 verse 20. In order to see his or her guilt, the sinners must test their character by God's great standard of righteousness. It is a mirror which shows the perfection of a righteous character, and enables them to discern the defects in their own. The law reveals to humans their sins, but it provides no remedy. While it promises life to the obedient, it declares that death is the portion of the transgressor. The gospel of Christ alone can free all from the condemnation or the defilement of sin. They must exercise repentance toward God, whose law has been transgressed, and faith in Christ, their atoning sacrifice. Thus they obtain remission of sins that are past, and become a partakers of the divine nature. Thus they are children of God, having received the Spirit of adoption, whereby He cries, Abba, Father. The works show whether the faith is genuine. Righteousness is right doing, and it is by their deeds that all will be judged. Our characters are revealed by what we do. We may believe that the name of Jesus is the only name under heaven whereby man may be saved, and yet we may not through faith make Him our personal Savior. It is not enough to believe the theory of truth. It is not enough to make a profession of faith in Christ and have our names registered on the church roll. He that keepeth His commandments dwelleth in Him, and He in him. And hereby we know that He abideth in us, by the Spirit which He hath given us. Hereby we do know that we know Him if we keep His commandments. 1 John 3 verse 24, 1 John 2 verse 3. This is the genuine evidence of conversion. Whatever our profession, it amounts to nothing unless Christ is revealed in works of righteousness. He or she who becomes a partaker of the divine nature will be in harmony with God's great standard of righteousness, His holy law. This is the rule by which God measures the actions of humans. This will be the test of character in the judgment. End time church condition. And they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places, thou shalt raise up the foundations of many generations, and thou shalt be called, the repairer of the breach, the restorer of paths to dwell in. Isaiah 58:12. The history of the church and the world is here plainly revealed. The loyal, under the proclamation of the third angel's message, have turned into the way of God's commandments. Thus they respected, honored, and glorified Him who created the heavens and the earth. The opposing forces have dishonored God by making a breach in His law. When light from His word has called attention to His holy commandments, revealing the breach made in the law by the papal authority, many have tried to destroy the whole law in order to get rid of conviction. But could they destroy it? No. For all who will search the scriptures for themselves will see that the law of God stands immutable and eternal. God's memorial, the Sabbath, will endure through eternal ages, pointing to the only true God. A line of distinction is being drawn between the children of obedience and the children of disobedience, the loyal and true and the disloyal and untrue. Two great parties are developed, the worshippers of the beast and his image, and the worshippers of the true and living God. The last great deception. Now Satan puts forward the claim that the law which was spoken by God's own voice is faulty and some specification has been set aside, he needs not to assail the whole law. If he can lead believers to disregard one precept, his purpose is gained. For whosoever shall keep the whole law, and yet offend in one point, he is guilty of all. James 2:10. Thus by breaking one precept they are brought under Satan's power. By substituting human law for God's law, Satan will seek to control the world. This work is foretold in prophecy. Of the great apostate power which is the representative of Satan, it is declared. He shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand. Daniel 7:25. Humans will set up their laws to counterwork the law of God. They will seek to compel the consciences of others. In order to enforce these laws, they will oppress their fellow men. Everyone will be tested. All will be called to choose between the law of God and the laws of men. Here the dividing line will be drawn. There will be but two classes. Every character will be fully developed. All will show whether they have chosen the side of loyalty or that of rebellion. Then the end will come. God will vindicate His law and deliver His people. Satan and all who have joined him in rebellion will be cut off. Conclusion. Satan's hypocrisy has been unmasked by Christ's life, trial, and death. Christ took upon himself human nature. By his perfect life demonstrated the falsity of the claims of him who constantly accuses those who are trying to obey God's law. And the blood of Christ shed on the cross is the everlasting, incontrovertible testimony that God's law is as immutable as is his own character. The crucifixion of Christ was a murder instigated by Satan and carried out by people who had separated themselves from God. In the day of judgment, when the death of Christ upon the cross is seen in all its reality, every voice will be hushed. Everyone will see that Satan is a rebel. God is love. He has shown that love in the gift of Christ. When he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life, John 3:16, he withheld nothing from his purchased possession. He gave all heaven, from which we may draw strength and efficiency, that we be not repulsed or overcome by our great adversary. But the love of God does not lead him to excuse sin. He did not excuse it in Satan, Adam, Cain, and in any other of the children of men. God will not disregard our sins or overlook our defects of character. He expects us to overcome in his name. The law of God vindicated. Give me understanding, and I shall keep thy law, yea, I shall observe it with my whole heart. Psalm 119 verse 34. Christ ascended and laid open before the heavenly beings the scene of the conflict. The fierce attacks that Lucifer made against him to prevent him from accomplishing his work on the earth were exposed. All the lies and accusations of him who had been an exalted angel were seen in their true light. It was seen that his professedly spotless character was deceptive. His scheme to exalt himself to supremacy was now fully discerned. When the issue was finally settled, every unfallen being expressed indignation at the rebellion. With one voice they extolled God as righteous, merciful, self-denying, and just. His law had been vindicated. The voice that spoke to Israel from Sinai is speaking in these last days to men and women, saying, Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Exodus 20 verse 3. The law of God was written with his own finger on tables of stone, thus showing that it could never be changed or abrogated. It is to be preserved through the eternal ages, immutable as the principles of his government.